Hello, welcome to this episode of our program, Daily Debate. As usual, we are discussing contentious debates. Today, touching on several headlines that has been on the spotlight in Egypt. One of them, of course, is the tragedy of the Russian Airbus. And, of course, today the cabinet statement said on Monday that works still continue at the Russian plane crash site in central Sinai, adding that it is expected to be completed later in the day. The statement added that the contents of the flight's two black boxes recorders will be examined in coordination with concerning authorities in Egypt. A Russian team that arrived in Cairo to participate investigating the plane crash, representatives from the plane industrial company and the plane's country of register. Earlier, a Russian plane carrying 196 bodies from the crash left Cairo night to Russia to return the bodies home. A Russian airliner had crashed on Saturday in the middle of Sinai Desert, killing all 224 people aboard. Now, this would be one of our headlines that will be discussed during the day, but this is not the only headline that we have. Of course, later on, we will be speaking about tourism and the doors of one of the tourism industry's biggest international events, which is World Travel Market, opened in London with Minister of Shems Azoua attending, and the Egyptian participation in this exhibition is the largest due to the contract signed with J. Walter Thompson Advertising Company to promote the Egyptian tourism in 27 foreign markets for the next 3 days. That's a major other headline here. Before we proceed with our discussion, let me first highlight another headline, which was the speech of President Fateh Sisi. Of course, during his speech at the 20th Culture Seminar at the Armed Forces, President Fateh Sisi urged people to wait for the outcome of an investigation to determine the exact reason of the Russian airliner crashed, killing the 224 people aboard. Presidential spokesman Ala Youssef said that the president kicked off his speech with a minute of silence for the plane's victim, but that was not only the only highlight, but rather President Sisi said that Egypt has regained its international status, stressing that Cairo's foreign policy is based on respecting the will of other nations and not interfering in the internal affairs. The president went on to urge the Egyptians to work together to overcome the current challenges facing the country, adding that the national unity is the sole guarantee to achieve that, and of course to face the challenges. He also tackled the efforts being exerted by the government to maintain security, stability, and to eradicate all sorts of terrorism, adding that the government is keen on achieving developments and security. Regarding gas supplies, President Sisi said that by the end of November, all factories will have the gas needs, as he added that by the end of November, the state will intervene to reduce the high prices of all basic goods. Many more also were said about investments and the investment climate, and he said that the country is very much keen on attracting more investment and in guaranteeing that the investment climate would be very much conducive to attract more investment. I guess to highlight the issue we have with us over the phone, Ambassador Gamal Bayoumi, who is the former former assistant foreign minister and head of the Arab Investors Union. Thank you for being with us, sir.
Thank you. Nice.
And we've seen all that you have been attending the seminar yesterday and the President Sisi's speech before the 20th Cultural Seminar of the Armed Forces. Now, President Fateh Sisi highlighted several points. Among them was attracting investments and the efforts made by the government in order to create a kind of conducive atmosphere for investments. Can you further illustrate on how he tackled this issue?
Yes, he touched many points. One very important point among what he discussed in his speech was investment and how to encourage investment in order to create more and more jobs, in order to solve the problem of employment for the youth, in order to make our young generation also be able to invest by himself on a very small and tiny projects, that we shall make loans and finance available for this type of youth who are ready to start business, their own business. Really, he promised also to solve any problem facing investors, or also whatever investors are complaining about, bureaucracy, of course, and this sort of problems they are facing.
Yes.
He promised to double the efforts in order to make energy, electricity available for investors. He gave the example that a new investor, the first thing he will be in need of is the electricity, of course, and we didn't have enough electricity to offer for newcomers.
Yes.
And now we are in a position, much better position, and it will be even much better.
Yes. The president also highlighted the importance of the small and medium enterprises, and he said that Egypt already has no problem with creating more and more of the factories and more of the small and medium enterprises. And also he highlighted how the government has been exerting its efforts in carrying on with making more and more factories. How important is such a work? I mean, here, creating factories, creating new mills. Yes, hello?
Yes.
Yes. Speaking about industry in itself and the importance of industry as part of Egypt's efforts for investments, sir.
Yes, he mentioned that economic development does not depend only on mammoth projects, that of course we should give room for small and tiny projects, even middle-sized investment and projects, and he encouraged the financiers, banks and so on, to make finance available for those who are establishing small and medium-sized enterprises, because it is faster and it creates jobs easily, and the government will concentrate on the infrastructure and the big projects such as the roads, or cultivating land in the form of agriculture and so on. Small industries and small projects is a way to create more jobs easier and in place. I mean, everyone can do this in his own small place or small town.
Mm.
The word behind all of this is employment. We are seeking employment in order to make everyone has the opportunity to work.
Mm. Two other issues the president highlighted, which is unity and unity. And again, he spoke very much about the importance of unity among Egyptians in order to be able to confront the upcoming challenges. How important is such a factor, and how the president spoke about this factor?
He talked about this because he was talking about how to solve problems, and he said that there isn't a sort of excellent or absolute solution for any problem. Solving problems is, after all, a political choice, even if we are solving an economic problem. So it is political choice, and the good political choice is a decision which makes everybody, or almost the majority, happy about. And unity here is a word, because behind unity is a confidence. Economic development based mainly on the confidence on what in what you are doing. And he asked the mass media especially to be more accurate, to not to attack without any real information. And he meant this also by asking Egyptians to maintain unity among them.
Yes.
Or at least to really hire something. So the minority who is not enjoying this or that, we should compensate them.
Right. Finally, sir, he also spoke about Egypt's foreign policy, and he illustrated that Egypt's foreign policy is based on respecting the will of other nations and not interfering in the internal affairs. But that was part of really what he said. Foreign policy, sir, how do you view
the idea is Egypt is becoming more eager to cover its interest in the whole world, that Egypt is becoming more strong and stronger, and Egypt will never use its strength against anybody. We are becoming more strong in order to make our life better, in order to serve the international peace, security and development of the world, that we are ready to give hand to all our partners, whether it is in the east, in the west. And he before explained that his visit, for instance, to China, it doesn't mean that Egypt is giving back to the United States or Europe. So as a matter of Egypt, as a matter of fact, Egypt and the Egyptians should be proud, of their foreign policy. We never invaded other countries, we never attack other countries, and we were always helping the stability. We were helping peace and development for all people of the world.
Yes, very much indeed. Ambassador Gamal Bayoumi, the Secretary General of the Arab Investors Union and former Assistant Foreign Minister, we thank you very much for joining us. To our second major headline, which is the tragic Russian plane crash, to this report, and we'll come back for discussion.
Russian ambassador to Egypt Sergei Karbashenko announced that the two black boxes of the Russian plane will be transferred to Moscow to analyze their content as part of the investigation into the circumstances of the incident. Karbashenko said that there is coordination between the Egyptian and Russian government to conduct the investigations into the cause of the crash. Minister of Civil Aviation Hossein Kamel had earlier said the black boxes will be analyzed by a central committee inside the Ministry of Civil Aviation, adding that representatives from the Russian side and the company the plane Airbus will participate in the process. Airbus A321, operated by the Russian airline under the brand name Metrojet, was carrying 217 passengers and 7 crew members from the Red Sea resort of Sharm el-Sheikh to St. Petersburg in Russia on Saturday morning when it disappeared from the radar 23 minutes after takeoff at an altitude of 31,000 feet. The source of the crashed charter flight was later found in Al-Hasna in North Sinai. Karbashenko stressed in a press conference on Sunday that the accident will not influence the strength of Russia's relations with Egypt. According to the Russian embassy in Egypt, there were no survivors, and there is an ongoing search for the bodies of some of the victims.
Right, to our headline, next headline in today's episode. And before I go on with our discussion, let me first welcome our for the day, Dr. Waleed Batouty, representative of the International Union of Tour Guides in the Middle East and North Africa. Thank you very much for joining us.
Thank you.
And Dr. Akram Allam, tourism expert. Thank you very much for joining us.
Thank you.
And just let us go on with a major headline that has been a real tragedy, I guess, for both Egypt and Russia at the same time because of the losses. But here, let me say that Prime Minister Ismail, or rather Sharif Ismail, and the Egyptian investigating teams arrived to the crash site at once. And they said that Egypt will be really investigating the whole issue, and that it is ready and fully ready to cooperate with the Russian side and all the parties in order to reveal what were the real causes of this. How did you view Egypt's ability to deal with crisis in this situation?
Well, the behavior of the Egyptian government and the act was very professional. They did not release any statement or anything like this regarding what happened, because they did not find the black boxes yet. And when they found the black boxes, then they said, okay, we'll analyze and we will work together with the Russians. Now, you need to understand one thing. This is a plane crash, okay? And a plane, the whole world wants to know what happened, so they avoid in the next one. If it's a mechanical failure, then they will make sure it doesn't happen. If it's in the plane, if it's in the, whatever happened, then they need to know. It's not that anyone gonna say it's not me or, no. Mm. This is an international thing, and it's for the whole world. For the manufacturing plane, for everything. So it's premature now what we've been hearing in the media, and people have been talking and assumptions, and some people are saying, but this happened, I heard a phone call between the pilot and his daughter. Where does this, all of this come from? And then some TV channels abroad, they've opened their channel 6 hours air. I wonder why they were doing this, and they don't know anything.
Yes.
There was not a single piece of information that has been released. I've been watching. The Egyptian government went over there, they fished for the black boxes, and then they said the situation, we found how many bodies, this is the plane, the crash site, and we're looking for the black boxes. Yes, we found the black boxes. Yes, they're in good condition. Take them. And then the secretary or the minister of transportation in Russia came, and he made a very interesting statement as well.
Yes, if I may take it from another side and speak about what Dr. Batouty here raised, which is how the international arena was looking into the incident and how they were getting out with speculations and all this kind of speculation so far, because we don't have any evidence of whatsoever that can really reveal the real cause. Now, from your point of view, how transparent was Egypt in transferring the reality to the world at once on the site?
Well, first of all, we're sending, Egyptian people are sending their condolences to the Russians and
yes.
to the families of the victims. We also have to understand that aviation accidents do happen, mm. and they will happen due to many different circumstances. And I think the Egyptian act was too quick and fast. And I think the communication made to the Russian President Putin was right on time. Also, the Russians sent their investigation teams. Yes. And I hear that they have left Egypt this morning back to Russia, because they showed their support and their trust in the Egyptian aviation task team or emergency or crisis team. And they have fully supported the Egyptian investigations and have agreed that they have to wait until the black boxes are analyzed. So let's not jump into conclusions. Let's just wait. But I think Egypt has done a wonderful job dealing with the crisis. Our media was, you know, a little quiet at the beginning, but now the news are all over. So they're talking about it very professionally. Squad teams are handling the situation very professionally, contacting the Russians and their families, and accepting or receiving their investigation teams very professionally, and carrying them to the site of the crash on the spot. So. I think Egypt has played a very important and very professional role, and we only have to wait for the results.
Yes. Technically speaking, if I want to take it from a technical side, there are some claims that it might have been intercepted, that the Airbus was intercepted in the air at this high altitude. Now,
who said
can
that?
It's different media. It's different media and different by many other outside the country, because nothing has been revealed yet. But from your point of view, of course, these were claims by some, but we are not taking the claims. But what I really want to take it from you as an expert. Can this happen by any way? What is the technical fatality that can happen to an airplane that can make it? I mean, here communications were cut, and then we don't know it was at this altitude, around 30 to 32,000 kilometers in the air. Now, how do you view this, technically speaking?
All right, I want to answer in two ways. First of all, the answer is in your question, because if you would tell me who the claim's coming from, then this is the answer. Then we don't need to go. Technically, I'm not a technical. I'm just a simple. I cannot really give my assumptions or give opinion about something. But I can tell you from what I read and from what I know, plus that I have an experience. You know, I'm related to the pilot for the Egypt Air 990 in the 31st of yes. October in 1999. And people were trying to say what a coincidence and what it is. And they called me and they come on television and to say things. It's irrelevant. But let me tell you, yes, I do have into this. If whoever says the interception, the plane is on 31 or 32,000 feet. The kind of missile that could be with the maximum height that it could reach is 4 kilometers. And the plane was above 10 or 12 kilometers, so there is no way. There is a 6 or 7 kilometers difference. There is no way, okay? And still, again, it's premature to say. Let me tell you something. The pilots have asked for emergency landing from the media that said that as well. Okay, so it needed, for example, the bureau chief of Al Jazeera. I'm saying the name, I'm sorry. Al Jazeera and CNN, they must have been on the cockpit with them. I mean, they left some in a certain point, because from the way they give the information as if they were inside.
Or they heard the black box before we do.
Or they heard the black box. Or maybe they're the ones who hid it. You know, the way they say, you know, because the Russian government, they said, we totally deny the assumptions that it could be a sabotage. Okay, the Russians, the one of the plane, from what they can see, from the circumstances, they said, definitely not. I have the feeling that Al Jazeera is saying, no, you're wrong, because we're the ones who hit it. Unless they do this, fine. I mean, but any other from that, this is... A pilot seeked mayday, mayday. He's asking for an emergency landing. He's asking to go down. So definitely he has something. It could be a mechanical failure. It could be weather. We've been having strange weather. We don't know yet, right? So as Mr. Akram said, we have to wait. The black boxes we have. It's a matter of hours, but people cannot wait. Everyone wants to have, I knew this. So I don't know where does those two TV channels, CNN opened 6 hours airtime, as if there's nothing in the world apart from this. Al Jazeera, of course, we know. I mean, they live on Egypt, so as if there's nothing in the world except Egypt for Al Jazeera. So, that, you know,
we have to keep in consideration that in a situation like this, rumors will come from right and left. Mm. We also have to keep in consideration the type of the airplane. The maker of the airplane, it's an Airbus. It's a war. It's an industrial war between Boeing and Airbus. Whenever an air crash happens, the first question is it an Airbus or is it Boeing? If it's Boeing, then the Airbus will cheer and say our planes are better. And if it's Airbus, the Boeing will start their media and say, well, our planes are safer. This is a war because this is a multi-billion dollar business. And we have seen this happening whenever any air crash happened. Secondly, I heard today that also a Russian aircraft was grounded from the airport in Sharm el-Hergada, actually, because they were not safe enough. They had maintenance problems. Let's also keep in consideration that some of these airlines, they use and they buy very cheap aircrafts, very used and abused. and their maintenance regulations are not exactly the highest, okay? And they are the ones running cheap charter flights. So maintenance is not in their priority list. All these things have to be kept in consideration. I heard someone talking to the radio this morning, and he said that the same plane carrying the same number in 2004 was grounded at Cairo Airport because they have lost a wing while they were still taxiing, you know? So there are so many things. I mean, why do we always tend to believe the bad news and to believe the news that is that might hurt us or cause damage
to
us?
Yes, it seems like it has become a habit.
So I think the best thing is that we all stay and be quiet and be calm and wait for the final analysis of the black boxes. Then everybody can bring his cards on the table, and then we can talk.
Right. Just finally to wrap up this headline and go on with another important headline of the day. And let me here ask you, from your point of view, how do you think this will reflect on the Egyptian-Russian relations? Because it is a matter of importance, I guess.
No, I don't think there will be any reflection at all. The relationship between Egypt and Russia is really tight and it's really good. And, you know, the president of Russia has been gaining reputation in Egypt. Everybody
he's
likes him.
He's gaining popularity.
And he's very popular in Egypt. I mean, people like him very much. No, I don't think anything will affect the. Both governments are acting very mature, very mature.
Actually, I called our friends in both cities, Sharm el Sheikh and Hurghada, today and found out that no cancellations. Mm. You know, the flights are still coming and there are no cancellations. So accidents do happen, and this will not stop the world from traveling.
Indeed.
Mm-hmm. Every year, accidents happen in the ski resorts in Switzerland, and still the people they go.
Yeah.
Yes.
Every year.
Yes, very much.
But CNN doesn't talk about it, as well as Al Jazeera. They don't.
And no, of course, Switzerland is not as important as Egypt's news. Let's just wrap up this issue for now. Of course, we're not laughing because it is a real tragic, but it has been tackled in a very weird way. Before just we concluded this headline, let's move to another important headline. And Egypt launches tourism promotion campaign at the WTM exhibition in London. Let's watch the report and we'll come back for discussion.
Ministry of Tourism launches its tourism promotion campaign at the World Travel Market WTM exhibition in London. A total of 42 Egyptian hotels and 30 travel agencies are participating in the campaign. Minister of Tourism Hisham Zazoua arrived in London on Sunday to participate in the conference and meet with international tourism companies. Sources described Egyptian participation in the WTM exhibition as its largest due to the contract signed with the JWT to market Egyptian tourism for 3 years. The Ministry of Tourism is currently coordinating with the Ministry of Foreign Affairs through the Egyptian ambassador in Moscow to discuss his visit to Rashid Dariki from London to meet with tour operators by the weekend. JWT's campaign will focus on the current winter season to increase the flow tourism of Egypt, especially to places suffering decline of tourism, including Luxor and Aswan and other destinations along the Red Sea.
Right, welcome back, and this is a little bit cheerful news, and this launching of this tourism campaign that starts in London. Let me take more news from both of you gentlemen. Mr. Batouty, please.
We've been presenting, Egypt has been presenting a lot of new things for the world. You know, we have Professor Reeves. He has come up with a new thing, a new theory. He says behind the burial chamber of King Tut's tomb, there is two more hidden rooms that no one gets to them. And he is claiming that those belongs to Queen, with the name of Queen Nefertiti. The Egyptian archaeologists are saying no. It might belong to somebody else, but there will be a debate over this. But I mean, to us, the news is Egypt news again. It is King Tut. Christopher Reeves wrote a very interesting book, The Complete Value of the Kings. This is a heavyweight man when it comes to Egyptology. The modern technology, by the way, which is 2 weeks later, there was another conference, press conference at the pyramids, and it was the whole team was headed by Minister Damati, Dr. Mamdouh Damati, the Minister of Antiquity, and by Dr. Hani Hilal, who is running the whole show or supervising the whole show. The show is called Scan the Pyramid. It's a French, Canadian, and Japanese, and they have new equipments. And this equipment, by the way, it will be used inside the tomb of King Tut, and it will give us three-dimension a picture of what's inside without touching anything. So if this goes in, which I believe very soon, I cannot really tell the date, but it's very soon happening, they will go in and picture, and they will tell us what's behind the walls and what's in those rooms. This is the discovery, inshallah, it will be the discovery of the 21st century. And then there is another one, which is in the Ashur Pyramid. There is some good news coming. I'm not entitled to announce, but there is in the Ashur Pyramid, and there is in Giza. And since this technology, modern technology, works and come up with new things, we're going to have to reintroduce all the sites of Egypt. I mean, we're going to have to scan every single site in Egypt again. Possibility of finding things that we missed before or they missed before. So this is going to put Egypt really in the attention of the whole world.
Yes, indeed. That's good news.
And as Egypt is back in full gear, we are using our history and our antiquities to again keep the world amazed and keep the world sitting on the edge of his seat. The two technologies that Mr. Batouty was talking about, they are certainly will be on the headlines all over the world. Because anything that brings the name of King Tut out, the world will be very eager to know. The pyramids is just the same, and the other pyramids too. So we will discover new things. We will have a new era in the Egyptian archaeology, and that will certainly bring the name of Egypt to the media and to the top again. So right. There is a lot of hope. It's good to see the archaeology is helping Egypt to position.
Has always been.
That's true.
This is only for your show. We're the first time for us to announce this. Because we're both working, so that's exclusive for you.
So that's the exclusivity of the such an announcement in our program, Daily Debate, and we are so flattered.
Thank you.
Now, the doors of one of the tourism industry's biggest international events, which is World Travel Market, that is taking London. Place in London. And there is an Egyptian delegation, huge delegation participating. Tell me, how is the Egyptian delegation participating in such a huge international event? And what is it exhibiting exactly? What is the campaign Egypt is launching?
Egypt is launching a new campaign. It's called This is Egypt. And I believe it was supposed to be Minister Hisham and Dr. Mamdouh Damati, Minister of Antiquity, they were supposed to launch also another thing that next year it will be the year of pyramids. Okay, this is just to let you know of the new things happening or coming up. But the interesting thing is, yes, Egypt has a lot to offer now and a lot of things coming. Those are in the market, they have no choice. Minister of Tourism or the people of the travel industry of Egypt, they are all over there and they have no choice except to do their best and work very hard. And the situation now is a little bit different and better than before. So they will be working hard. Let me tell you the good news is business, and I cannot say that business is back to normal. But there is business in Egypt right now. Well, maybe we kept it low profile, maybe we didn't talk much about it, but we can both assure you now there is tourism on ground, especially in some of the markets. I mean, we have a problem with the French market, we have a problem with the Italian market, but definitely we don't have a problem now with the Spanish market. Sometimes people, they say, but I don't get some work. I mean, we know this from our friends. Well, I'm very sorry. Only the good ones now is going to work. You know, we have to wait till, you know, we have mass production and then, you know, those who cannot
gradually
really
they will get
gradually.
Yes.
Yeah, gradually they will
business
they will get
will come
it.
Back. Actually, I'm in the middle of a tour now. I'm conducting a tour now, and I'm right in the middle of it. I had a very long day today, and we toured some
good.
Wonderful sites, and the people were so happy. And actually, I left them at dinner, and I came here for you. You know, so there.
Not very
coming.
Good for you.
No, it's okay. Okay. I mean, there is business. There are tours on the ground. I just came from a Nile cruise. And we stopped at Komombo, and there were 22 cruise ships when we arrived. Mm. So I was so glad to see tears in my eyes, you know, seeing all these boats working again, you know. So definitely it's coming back. And I always say the world cannot do without Egypt any longer than that. Mm. You know, the people, they want to come to Egypt. And the people I had today on my tour, I asked them personally and individually, did you feel any uncomfortableness coming to Egypt? Were you afraid? They said, maybe my brother told me not to go, my neighbor told me be careful. But they said, once we landed in Egypt and we met the people of Egypt, either in the streets or in the sites, they said, we called them and we told them, you were wrong. We're having a great time. Everything is normal. The people are welcoming us. Let me tell you this, because I have to bring it to attention. We might learn something from this. We were in the Valley of and we were riding the little transportation to take us to the sites. And I had two of my tourists with me. And they are from the U.S. And four local girls from Luxor, teenagers, they were sitting next to us. And then they wanted to have a conversation with these tourists, and I encouraged them. And they started the conversation. With the little few words of English with, you know, that the girls spoke, they called each other. One of them ran out to one of the stores and bought a nice gift to the tourist and presented it to her. And that tourist woman, she had tears in her eyes. She said, this is a wonderful thing. I never met that girl before. She only talked to me a few words, and she was so sincere, and she gave me a present. You know, I mean, I told that girl in Arabic, you have done your country a great, you know, a great favor.
Mm.
Because if all of us welcome the tourist and support them and tell them that you are welcomed, you know, and there's no fear, we'll get the business back faster than it is now. Okay.
The human touch.
Very touching, touch. Yes.
Yeah.
Very touching, but that is the very into Egyptians.
That's true. That's our culture.
You know, we have a very famous composer in Egypt. He composed here in Egypt. And he was supposed to leave the day before yesterday. Oh. You know that he's still in Egypt and he doesn't want to go?
Yes. Yes.
Yeah.
And we want to speak about Sieni, and because, yes, we've all seen the end of his show when he ended with Long Live Egypt in yeah. that for three times. And yes, tell me all about this, because he was one of those who were propagating for the in the campaign, This Is Egypt. So tell us more about this.
Look, I've worked with him, a very interesting human being. And no wonder he is a composer, and no wonder he is a lovely artist. I mean, he's unbelievable.
He's a great pianist anyway, and
that is
he
true.
Has
and his band, by the way, do you know that everyone in his band is the best in the world in that instrument? Mm. And part of the show, they show this, but he said, I felt Egypt in JFK at the terminal just before I got on the plane. And then when he got on the plane, he found a chocolate. Name on it. It's been presented to him on board the national carrier that came on. I don't know if this is a commercial to them or not, but this is something that we have really to emphasize. Everyone, as Mr. Akram was saying, everyone felt it's my job to comfort this man. From the moment he arrived at the airport and the people they met him and the organizer who've organized the whole thing and put it together, Yanni aired from the terminal, Egypt, here I come. And then he got on the plane and he took a picture with the flight attendants and he says, I am in Egypt now, because he got on the plane, so that's Egypt. It's not even if it's in JFK. And then when he landed in Cairo airport, I cannot tell you the way he was greeted and the way they met him and the security. I have to stop here for a second and say how many times he stopped me and says, Waleed, I want you to tell the officers that you know, they're the bosses of my personal security assigned by the Egyptian government. I want to thank them. He says, I've been around the world. I've never seen something. They are so sincere. They really like me. They're not just doing their job. No, they're going out of their way. He says, everyone wants to
comfort me. Now, he's still in Egypt, and he did not leave. And it's open. We don't know when he's going
to
go.
He wants to learn more.
And he's been extending.
Welcome anyway.
Yeah.
And he wants to learn more about Egypt. He's eating molokhia at the hotel. he loves molokhia. He can have it after the party. But we discovered that that he's been ordering every day. Every day. He orders at night. He comes at the hotel after the rehearsal. And he eats molokhia. And he loves Egypt. He goes out to the balcony. And then he makes a video. And he's addressing people.
All over the world.
No, on a one-to-one talk, he says, Waleed, I'm not happy. I'm not happy. What has been done to Egypt is not right. That's not fair. This is a lovely country. The people, I want to say something to the people of Egypt that I just want to tell them how much I do. It's been my dream to come here. It is not that you guys want me to come and perform in Egypt. Okay, no, it has always been my dream. In the press conference, he didn't know me yet because he walked in, lots of security. So press people were asking questions and I asked if I could ask a question. And I said, Yanni, many years ago, me a video, God bless her soul. My mother bought me a video of your concert at Yanni at the Acropolis and you dedicated a song to your mother. So he went like this when I mentioned his mother. And I said, my mother, she told me, Waleed, one day you will guide this man. And the dream come true. And he went like this, and he had tears in his eyes. And then when we went out on the side, he said, where's my tour guide? And from that moment, I stayed with him. And he says, you tell me this. And he's so excited that he's here in Egypt. He loves Egypt. He's making a video. This is another one for you. Mm. He's making a video about Egypt that it will be the demo of a certain brand, I cannot say the name, one of the biggest electronics CD, LCDs and LEDs and all the screens in the world. And it will be shown in 24,000 spots around the world, places that sells these LEDs and screens, 24,000 spots around the world, showing Egypt as the demo of that type of TV screens, and he brought special cameras with him. It's the highest technology in the world. It's not high definition. It's the 4K. It's not been used yet, and he's doing a film about Egypt, and he's giving the film for no charge for Egypt as a gift. He says, I want to do something for this country. This country have done a lot to humanity, and I don't know if we'll be able to air. There is a video I gave, which is especially
if we have in our studios here, we have this video that we had from Mr. Batouty.
Yeah, Scott Kelly.
That would be great.
Scott Kelly is his friend,
an astronaut
in the space, and he surprised everyone. Right when the show finished, he says he was taking his breath, and then he says. To all the people of Egypt, I have something special for you, all of you. You deserve it. This is for you. And then we have monitors on both sides. And the screen comes from the astronaut Scott Kelly in NASA up in the space, talking to us. And then he says, I come often over Egypt. And he shows a picture of the Nile and the lights and the pyramids. And he says, I pass from here all the time. And this is my lovely place, and I like to watch it. But I've watched the show with you. So we aired the concert that happened 2 days ago. It's been aired to the space shuttle, and he watched it with us. And then he aired back to us on Earth a message of peace, a message of love, a message of no boundaries. We all should live together, okay? And then he flipped. See what one single artist can do? The whole world. NASA has a channel 24/7 and people watch. How many millions of people? And when Yanni goes home and he finishes the DVD that is going to be about Egypt, we have done some touring. He went in certain places in Egypt that he wanted to go. One of them was Shara al Muaz, the Muaz Street, and he asked to go in a mosque. And he knows a lot about us and about Islam.
Yeah, being Greek.
And yes, he's Greek, you know. So you could feel.
So this is what Yanni really, or he really expressed his feelings, or this was what Yanni's, or and how he felt here in Egypt. What about the world? How did the world perceive Yanni's?
Well, I posted some of my pictures at the concert on my social media page, and I got people from all over the world, you know, wondering, how was it? How was it? Was it good? I wish I was there. I wish I was there. I wish I was there.
I wish so everybody would be there.
I'll tell you an interesting story. I was sitting there at the concert, and there were two elderly couples sitting right next to me. They're foreigners. So they were, as they were leaving the concert, so courteously I said, did you like the show? And they said, oh, wonderful. We had a great time. And they asked me the same question. And did you like the show? I said, oh, my goodness. The show, and I really enjoyed it immensely. And the lady said, did you like the violinist? I said, yes. She said, she's my daughter. And she said, we came from the UK to watch her play here. She said, we followed her all over the world in her concerts with Yanni, but she said, this one is very special, you know? So these were very strong words, because she played all over the world, but the mother said, if her daughter plays in Egypt, you know, that's very special.
Everyone from the band, I went and saw their social media. Each and every one of them made their own video. Now imagine, I had the first day with Yanni, the second day, and there was the yesterday. We had a free day, and we expected Mr. Yanni would do something, but I couldn't, because there is the number one architect in the world, known number one architect in the world, came all the way from California to attend Yanni's show in Egypt. And he asked from his host in Egypt here to have the same guy that was working with Yanni. So I went with him yesterday. I was really tired, but you cannot say no, right? And this man also is a big shot. So this is to show you, among the people that were here, we had a lot of Jordanians. The Jordanian people, there were over 300
and people from the Emirates.
United Arab Emirates, Saudis, Kuwaitis, I mean, from all over, even though he's supposed to, I think, to be performing in Sharjah in a few days, but he's still in Egypt, you know, and every day he postpones, and he wants to do sites, and he wants to do this, and he wants to learn about lots of things. And the people of Egypt, at the hotel where he's staying in one of the historical hotels in Egypt, overlooking the Nile. Mm. And the hotel itself has history. He says, I have stayed in lots of hotels around the world. They treat me like a king, but I never felt like this. He says, what can I do? Is this normal? I said, this is Egyptian thing. This is how the Egyptian react to people who does good things to them. That's why he put the flag. And he asked, and he's been training on Tahya Masr. And he asked, and he Googled it, and he found that it was the first time it's been said, 1919. You know, it's very intellectual. And he's here with his own daughter that become
now
very famous.
What's the lesson learned from this? When are we going to wise up and bring people like Yanni?
But there was somebody else other than Yanni. It was also
Morgan Freeman. Yeah.
Yes, no. I'm speaking Morgan. About another artist, and I'm speaking about Morgan Freeman.
I went with him too.
Yes,
yeah,
so
but he was coming for business. He was not coming for a concert.
Yes,
what
however,
about if we have a big name like Yanni every 6 months at the pyramids? Can you imagine the impact? Can you imagine the media? Can you imagine the world? Why don't we make Cairo, you know, like the center of world concerts? Why don't we have a schedule for all these great artists from worldwide to come and perform here? Now we've learned, we've gained some experience from handling Yanni's concert. Now we know how to handle big names. We know how to handle the stage. We know how to handle the security. We know how to handle the ticketing. We know how to handle the receiving and everything. So why don't we, since we learned the lesson now, and we learned it the right way, so why don't we invite another big name, a singer, an entertainer, an athlete, whatever, and we invite them to Egypt to perform at the pyramids, let's say every 6 months. If we get two big names every year, Egypt will be on the top again.
Yes, and we are extending, of course, your message here to the authorities, and why not? That would
and
be something
every,
great for Egypt.
Every artist I've met in my life and in my business, they wish to come and perform in Egypt.
But
that's the dream of everyone.
Without the help of the government, I have to really admit, without the help of the government, it was not going to happen, because I saw this with my own eyes. Their small employees have always tried to put obstacles. The organizer
is really thinking of may not do anything else because the amount of obstacles that has been put in his way.
Bureaucracy
like no one can imagine. And you keep telling, we're doing this for Egypt. I don't care. I've heard this a lot of times. Then you have to go to a superior power, and without them, it wasn't going to happen, honestly. I mean, there was one lady, she shut the lights off and she says, sorry, I don't care. I gotta, either you pay me so much amount of money or no. The guy wanted to go to the pyramid at night to see the stage. He was so excited. So, I mean, that's...
For rehearsal.
That's one thing that... in his mind, and he's an artist, and he thinks that it's okay to go. So we need to light that. And you know, we made it simple for him, and he says, you know, we're not lighting an apartment or a supermarket, that we're lighting the pyramid, and we made it big as well. Mm. And you understand, and he was very okay with it. But bureaucracy has to totally stay away from this. The organizer needs help, not obstacles. As Mr. Akram says, I mean, this man brought before Shakira, Bocelli, I mean, big things. We need to bring these things, and it brings attention of the world to Egypt.
Let's learn to listen.
And when you see the Egyptians that came as well, very elegant, the people. The reception, the lighting, the clothing, the behavior, when the artist walked on stage. And then he really did this for the Egyptians because he wanted to do something to please the Egyptian more. So he knew that the flag is going to drive the crowd. That's why he even left it at the end. He put the flag of Egypt. He said, Tahya Mas, long live Egypt, 3 times. He's been training on it. He did care. Okay? The audience was marvelous. I mean, they did... and everybody knows his music. I mean, the people went there.
Yes.
They knew his music. The officers that was over there. You know what? He told me, I want to take a picture with these officers over there. I know it might be forbidden, but tell them I'm not going to use it. This is personal. These guys, they look great. You know what? You guys are very lucky. You have men in uniform. They saved your country. I'm telling you the personal things he said to me.
Yes. These are very personal things that has been said by an artist, but it also shows that how Egypt is being looked at from the outside world and from very, I mean here, not just the ordinary people and nations, but rather those who are even elites and how they see Egypt. And yes, that also makes me so proud to be an Egyptian.
You know, sure. Just before you wrap up, I want to tell you one last thing. He said to the Minister of Antiquity, Dr. Domati, and to the organizer when we went to the, he asked for the Grand Museum. One of the things, you know, and we said, what, you want to go to the Egyptian Museum? He says, I want to go to the Grand Museum.
The new museum.
The new museum that is under construction. And when he went to the platform, he took the hand of the Minister of Antiquity and he took of the organizer and took the hand of the curator, the manager of the new museum, and says, promise me I'll be part of the opening. This is history.
Wow.
Yes, this is history. You're making history.
So that's another announcement that we're speaking about here. That's another announcement. Unfortunately, I have to end it here. Really, unfortunately. Mr. Waleed Batouty, representative of the International Union of Tour Guides in the Middle East and North Africa, thank you very much for joining us. Yeah. And Mr. Akram Allam, tourism expert, thank you very much
thank
for
you.
Being with us.
Thank you for having us.
And yes, as you have seen, this is Egypt. We have tragedy, we have cheerful news, and we have it all. This is Egypt. Good night.